Hello guys, welcome to Bhavna's Online Academy. So in this video, we are going to learn AS16, that is about the borrowing cost. So there is going to be two parts to this video. Part number one will be covering all the concepts of borrowing cost, and in part number two, I'll be solving sums. Okay. So now today, you can have a look at this, and part two will be uploaded in a day or two. Yes. So let's start with the AS16. Yes. So first, let's see like a summary of what AS16 talks about. This is like a summary. Okay. So what it says is there is a asset. So what AS16 says, there is a asset. Okay. This asset is a qualifying asset. So this asset is a qualifying asset. So now what is qualifying asset? That we will learn when we are studying the AS16. Okay. So there is asset which is a qualifying asset. Okay, fine. This asset can either be purchased or this asset can be constructed. So this qualifying asset is there. It can either be purchased or it can be constructed by ourselves. Okay. So for purchasing, so for either purchasing this qualifying asset or for constructing this qualifying asset, what we do is we borrow funds. What we do? To purchase this qualifying asset or to construct this qualifying asset, we are borrowing funds. Okay, so from where can we borrow funds, or what are the sources from where we can do this borrowing? You can get funds in the form of bank loan. You can get funds in the bank in the form of bank loan, or you can also get funds by issuing debentures. Okay, so you can get money either by by taking a bank loan or by issuing debentures. Okay, so in that form you will get your money. Okay, and this money, using this money, you will either purchase or you will either construct. Okay, so this is your borrowing. You will have to repay this. Okay, so this money is your borrowing. You will have to repay this. Okay, so on this borrowing, okay, so on this borrowing, there will be some kind of a borrowing cost. In case you are taking a bank loan, that is from the bank, if you are taking a loan, they will not give the loan for free. They will charge you something known as interest. Okay, so interest also they will charge you. What is this interest? This interest is nothing but your borrowing cost, which you are paying for getting that borrowing. Okay, so there will be a borrowing cost which is incurred. Example, it may be called as your interest. Okay, in debentures also you pay interest. There are lot the other different kinds of borrowing costs which I'll be discussing below. There are many kinds of borrowing costs, one of which is your interest. Okay, so what the standard says is that this interest which is there, okay, which is there, you know, which you are paying on the borrowing, the interest, you will capitalize it. You will capitalize it. So what this capitalization means? It means that this interest, suppose you have got a borrowing of rupees 10 lakh for making the asset. Okay, suppose for making the asset and your interest is rupees 1 lakh. Then what this AS says is that this interest of 1 lakh should be capitalized. What does capitalization means? It means that it should be added with the cost of the asset. Added to the cost of the asset. Okay. So this 1 lakh rupees, what you are going to do is you are going to add to the cost of the qualifying asset. You are going to add to the cost of the qualifying asset. Suppose the qualifying asset worth 50 lakh rupees, then you will go and add your interest amount of 1 lakh with this. So the total cost of this asset will become 51 lakh rupees. So you'll add it with the cost of the asset. So this is what the whole AS is talking about. Now in this AS, what we are going to learn is what is qualifying asset, what is borrowing cost, what will be the conditions when you will capitalize this. So all those little things is what we are going to learn in this chapter. So this was a complete overview. Okay, so yes, so now let's start with our concept. Okay, so first we are going to learn about borrowing cost. So first we are going to learn about borrowing cost. So what is borrowing cost? So borrowing cost is incurred when you borrow funds. Borrowing cost is incurred when you borrow funds. That is what is written here. Borrowing cost in connection with the borrowing of funds. That is, yes, then only it can be called as a borrowing cost. So borrowing cost or interest, which I already discussed, and other cost. So there are a few more costs which they are mentioned here as other costs incurred by an enterprise, because here we see that enterprise is taking a borrowing and either purchasing a or constructing a qualifying asset. Okay, so in connection with the borrowing of funds. Okay, so what are the different kinds of borrowing costs? So here they have given you five, you know, separate costs which you will call as borrowing costs. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. So what are these five costs which will be considered as borrowing costs is what we are going to understand. So here whatever they have given, these are all other costs only. So other cost here they have mentioned, you know, what are these other costs only? They have given down as five components. Interest is already there, and plus these five components will also be known as your borrowing cost. So what are those five components is what we are going to understand now. Okay, fine. So the first one, what they say is interest. Interest that I have already told you what interest is, and commitment charges on borrowings. So this is also borrowing cost. So interest, you all know what it is. Then what is commitment charges on borrowing is what we are going to understand. Suppose you have taken a 1 crore. Suppose you have taken 1 crore rupees of bank loan. Okay, so what happens is that 60, now for now, as of now, you need only 60 lakh rupees. You need only 60 lakh rupees for the asset. 40 lakh rupees you don't need now. That means 1 crore rupees you have taken as a bank loan. So in this month, for this month, you don't need the whole 1 crore. Next month only you will need the remaining 40 lakh. So 60 lakh rupees alone you withdraw this month for the asset. Okay, so 60 lakh rupees alone you withdraw for the asset. Okay, so for the 60 lakh, so here now the bank has given you 1 crore loan. The bank has put the 1 crore in your bank account. Okay, so in your account I may say. Okay, so this 1 crore rupees bank has given in your account. Now it is up to you when you want to take it, when you don't want to take it, or when you want to withdraw it or not withdraw it. Okay. So it completely depends on you. So what you decided is first 60 lakh you will withdraw. Okay. So on the 60 lakh rupees which you have withdrawn, what you are going to incur will be known as your interest charges. What you will incur will be known as your interest charges. Whereas the 40 lakh rupees which is there in your account, on that you will have to pay commitment charges. Why commitment charges? Because see, in from the bank 1 crore has been put into your account. Now that bank cannot use that 1 crore rupees. Correct. Only you can use the 1 crore rupees now. So what happens here is this 40 lakh rupees, even though you are not using, you cannot say that I won't pay anything on this, any charges I won't pay, you cannot say. Okay, because this 40 lakh rupees is going to be like a idle money now. So this is going to be idle money now. Neither bank is going to use. At least if bank was using, it would have earned something. Now that is also not using. The bank is also not using. So you cannot say I won't pay interest charges also on this, because I am also not using. So what the bank says is that in such case you have to pay something known as your commitment charges. So in on such 40 lakh rupees which are there idly in your account, for that you will have to pay something known as commitment charges, because so that the bank is earning something. Okay, so this is what is commitment charges. Next is amortization of discount or premium on borrowings. So what happens is that when you borrow, okay, so suppose what happens, you know, there is some kind of a discount. Once again, yes. So what happens is when you are doing your borrowings, if there is some kind of a discount or some kind of a premium, that is being amortized. Okay, and that is being amortized. This will also be included in your borrowing cost. Okay, so example for this would be that suppose in case you have issued debentures, in case you have issued debentures, and if you have issued your debentures at discount, okay, or if you have redeemed your debentures and you have redeemed the debentures at premium. Okay, so if you have redeemed your debentures at premium, here what happens, when you give something as discount, it is your cost only. The same way, when it is redeemed at premium, also it is your cost only. Okay, so both are the cost to the company only. So this, when this is and all, and when this is amortized, this will also get included in your borrowing cost. This will also get included in your borrowing cost. This is not related to preference shares. Okay, this is not related to preference shares, only on borrowings. In borrowings, your preference shares will not come. If you have given some discount, or if you have given some kind of a premium to preference shares, that will not be included. Only the discount or premium which was a cost for the debentures, that will only be included. So preference shares shall not be included here. Okay, so this is also a borrowing cost. Okay, so the next is ancillary cost related to borrowing, so other cost. Okay, next, fourth and fifth is important. So they say finance charges for assets acquired on finance lease. Finance charges on assets acquired for finance lease. If you people would have watched my AS 19 lecture, you would have understood what this is. But anyway, I'll explain you here again. So there is a person who is a lessor and there is a person who is a lessee. So what happens here is lessor will be the owner of the asset here and lessee will be the person who will get the asset on some kind of a rent, we can say. Okay. So for that, this lessee will pay something known as lease payments. Since the lessee is using the asset, of the lessor, he will pay something known as lease payments to the lessor. Okay. So this lease payment will include both the interest and the principal, and this interest is known as finance charges. Okay, if you didn't understand the concept properly, you can go and watch my AS 19 lecture so you will understand what it is. Okay. Yes. So he will pay something known as interest and principal, in which interest is called as finance charges. So that finance charges which he is paying for the asset acquired on finance lease, that will also be known as a borrowing cost. That will also be known as your borrowing cost only. Okay. Next, finally, exchange differences are also a part of borrowing cost. So first, let's revise this. First, your interest is your borrowing cost. Your commitment charges on borrowing is your borrowing cost. Your discount or premium in borrowings is also borrowing cost. Then your finance charges, which you are paying for the finance lease, is also borrowing cost. And your exchange difference is also your borrowing cost. So now, what is this exchange difference? Okay. So now, what is this exchange difference and how do we include it in our borrowing cost? So this is an important point now. So let's understand exchange difference. So they say, you know what is exchange difference? Exchange difference is nothing but our currency. There might be a difference between our Indian currency and the US currency. So that rate difference which is there, that is known as the exchange difference. I think you will know this. Okay, so if you don't know this exchange difference or what it is, go watch my AS 11 lecture, AS 11. Okay, yes. So here what is it related to exchange difference is that exchange differences arising on foreign currency borrowing, to an extent they are an adjustment to interest cost. So what they say is this exchange differences which are arising on foreign currency borrowings, that means in case if you have not, so here we are reading about borrowing cost, correct? For this borrowing cost to happen, you have to do some kind of a borrowing. So what they say is, in case you have done this borrowing from USA and not from India, then what will this borrowing be called? This borrowing will be called as your foreign currency borrowing, because you would have borrowed, suppose, $10,000. Then in such case, this will be known as your foreign currency borrowing only, if you have borrowed from some other country other than India. Okay. So what they say is this exchange difference, whatever is there, to an extent, they will be adjusted to interest costs. So what does this line mean? I know you wouldn't have understood it properly. So now let's take an example to understand this properly. So what has happened here is there is a company known as XYZ Limited. They have taken a loan of $10,000. So USD 10,000 means they have taken. So this XYZ limited company has taken a loan. They have taken a loan of $10,000, that is $10,000. Okay. So on April 1, 2001, for a specific project at an interest rate of 5% per annum, payable annually. So why they have taken this loan is that they have taken this loan for some project, to do some project, and the interest rate of this loan is 5% per annum. The interest rate of this loan is 5% per annum. Okay. On April 1, 2001, the exchange rate between the currencies was 45 per USD. So exchange rate between the countries was 45 per USD means for 1 rupee. sorry, for $1, you have to pay 45 rupees. For $1, you will have to pay 45 rupees. Okay. So, this was the exchange rate which was prevailing when he got the loan. So, when he got the loan, this was the exchange rate. Okay, fine. That means, here we'll also write, that means when he have to repay the loan of $10,000, what he would have thought on 1st April. So, today I took a loan and today the exchange rate is 45 rupees. So, what would I think? That means I would think that I have to repay $10,000, and since today my exchange rate is 45, I have to repay how much rupees in Indian rupees? How much should you repay? 450,000 is what you have to repay. This is what the XYZ Limited would have thought on 1st April. But now what happens? See, on 31st March as the year end came, it became 48 per USD. Oh my God, what happened? This turned into $1 equal to 48 rupees by the year end. That is, on 31st March, what happened? How much will he have to repay now? For $10,000, he have to repay at 48 rupees exchange rate. That means he have to repay now 480,000 rupees instead of 450,000. Why? Why should he repay 30,000 extra? Because the exchange rate has risen. That means our money value has got down. Okay, fine. So now he has to repay 480,000. Oh my God. So the corresponding amount have been borrowed by XYZ Limited in local currency at an interest rate of 11% per annum as on April 1, 2011. So in the last line, what they are trying to say is, if the loan was to be borrowed by XYZ Limited in local currency, if they had to borrow the loan on local currency, that means on 1st of April, if they had to borrow a loan from Indian people, okay, they would have to pay an interest of 11% per annum. Whereas when they took a loan from foreign currency, it was only 5% per annum. But if they had to take a loan from India, it would cost them 11% per annum. That's why they went and took a loan from foreign countries. Usually, as compared to Indian market, the foreign market provides loan at a lesser interest rates. And that's why people prefer taking loans from outside the country also. Okay. So, this is what they are saying here. Okay. So, now what they have told you is to find out the borrowing cost. So now they have told you to find out the borrowing cost. So this is what we have understood from the question. Okay. So this is what we have understood from the question, that on 1st April, the rate was $1 equal to 45 and he had to pay only 450,000 rupees. Whereas by the year end, 31st March came, $1 became 48 rupees and now he have to pay 480,000, 30,000 rupees he has to pay extra. Also, what he says is, on 1st April, if he had to take the loan from India, he would have to pay 11% per annum. But since he is taking from foreign country, he only has to pay 5% per annum. So now I already told you that 30,000 rupees is your borrowing cost. 30,000 rupees is your borrowing cost. Why 30,000? So this exchange difference, not your borrowing cost. So 30,000 rupees is your exchange difference. Because see, 450,000 and 480,000. So 30,000 is the exchange difference which you'll have to pay extra. So this 30,000 will be your cost. This is not a benefit to you. Okay, this is not benefit to you. Paying 30,000 is extra a benefit to you? No, this is a cost to you. So what is this cost? This cost is due to your borrowing. This cost has incurred due to your borrowing. So this will be known as your borrowing cost. Okay, but now, this total 30,000 rupees, will you take it as a borrowing cost or not? Or what you are going to do with this is what we are going to understand now. Okay. So, what they say is that, so see here, interest payable for US loan. So, how much interest would you pay for US loan? So, you have taken a loan of $10,000. You have taken it at a rate of 5%, and since you are going to pay it at the year end, the exchange rate that you are going to use is also 48 rupees only, because at the repayment of the loan time, I mean, by every year end only you are paying the interest also. Correct. So year end, what is the rate? Year end rate is 48 rupees. So $10,000 at 5% you are going to pay, and 48 rupees is what you are going to pay for each dollar. That means totally 24,000 rupees is your interest. 24,000 rupees is your interest. Okay. Now, in case the same loan was taken from India, then what would have been the interest? So, the interest payable for Indian loan. In case they would have taken from India, in that case, what would have been the, what would have been the rate at which they have to pay? Okay. So, they took a loan. They took a US loan of 4,50,000. So, they took a loan of $10,000. That means for 4,50,000 rupees is what the company needed. So, they took 10,000 from foreign as a loan. So, on this 4,50,000 rupees, for India, he will have to pay a interest. He will have to pay interest of 11%. The company has to pay interest of 11%. So on 4,50,000 rupees, if the Indian people have Indian, the company have to pay 11%. That means totally the interest that the company would have to pay is 49,500. Whereas for US loan, they only had to pay 24,000. Okay, so because of this interest difference only, they had taken a US loan. Correct. Okay. So, what is the difference between them? So, the difference between interest payable for US loan and interest payable for Indian loan. So, the difference is 25,500. That means this 25,500 is what the extra cost would they have incurred if they have taken Indian loan. Or also, we can say in this way that this 25,500 is the amount which they are paying less because they have taken a US loan. Okay, so that is the difference, 25,500. Okay, fine. Yes, so this difference until this, I hope you are clear. So now what this A16 says is that this exchange difference, whatever you get, how much exchange difference that we got exchange difference of 30,000. So whatever exchange difference you get, to the extent they are adjustment to interest cost. To the extent they are adjustment to interest cost. So, how much was the interest cost adjustment? 25,500 rupees was the interest cost adjustment. Correct. So, to the extent they are in adjustment to interest cost, we will consider them as borrowing cost. So, I'll explain this again. So, exchange difference arising out of foreign currency borrowings. How much exchange difference did we get from foreign currency borrowing? 30,000 rupees. To the extent they are an adjustment to interest cost, you can take it as borrowing cost. How much, to what extent was it an adjustment to borrowing cost? It was 25,500. So, this 25,500 will be considered as your borrowing cost. And how much is remaining? So, the remaining would be 30,000 minus 25,500. That is 4,500 remaining exchange difference will be taken to P&L. So, this 25,500 rupees, I told you it will be considered as a borrowing cost. So, if it is going to be considered as a borrowing cost, it means that it is going to be capitalized. Capitalized means it will be added to the cost of the asset, whereas this remaining 4,500 rupees, which is not an adjustment to the interest cost, will be taken to P&L and it will be debited. Okay, so I hope this is clear to you. So this was regarding the exchange differences. Okay, fine. So now until this you would have understood. Okay, so now borrowing cost you have completely understood. So now let's move on to what is a borrowing, or what are the things for which you can borrow. Okay, so here they tell you that, see, for borrowings only you are going to incur borrowing cost. For when you take borrowings only, you will incur borrowing cost. Correct. Like example, interest, you are going to incur interest. So what they say is this borrowings you can do for taking a qualifying asset or for making a other than qualifying asset. So you can borrow money either to make a qualifying asset or to make a asset which is other than some qualifying asset. Okay. So what they tell you is, in case you are borrowing to make a qualifying asset. In case you are borrowing to make a qualifying asset, then in such case the borrowing cost will be capitalized. That means the borrowing cost will be added to the cost of the qualifying asset. It will be added to the cost of the qualifying asset. Okay. So what they tell you is you can either borrow for creating qualifying asset or for other than qualifying asset. So for this borrowings, anyway, you will incur something known as borrowing cost. So if this borrowing is made for qualifying asset, in such case, the borrowing cost will be capitalized. In such case, the borrowing cost will be capitalized. Whereas if you are going to borrow money to make other than qualifying asset, then in such case, the borrowing cost shall be debited to P&L. So in such case, the borrowing cost shall be debited to P&L. So I hope it is clear to you now. So now let's understand what is qualifying asset. Okay. So what is qualifying asset? So here they tell you that qualifying asset is asset which takes substantial period. Once again. Yes. So it takes substantial period of time to get ready for its intended use or sale. So what they say is qualifying asset is nothing. It is asset only. It is asset which necessarily takes substantial period of time to get ready. So how much time to get ready? It must at least take substantial period of time to get ready. So substantial period of time to get ready means how much is this substantial period? So what amount of period can you call a substantial period? So here they say is substantial period depends on facts and circumstances of each case. So it can be different for each case, but ordinarily a period of 12 months. So ordinary, a period of 12 months is considered as a substantial period. So 12 months will be considered as your substantial period unless a shorter or longer period can be justified. So usually you will take substantial period as 12 months only. If you think there is a longer period or a shorter period which you will consider as a substantial period, then you can, if it is justified, then you can take it as your substantial period. But ordinarily, it is 12 months only. So what they say is, if an asset is taking around 12 months to either get ready for its use or sale, then in such case, you can call that asset a qualifying asset. So now here I can give you an example. Okay. So example, if you are going to purchase a machinery, if you are going to purchase a machinery today for 100 crore rupees, okay, and this 100 crore rupees, if you want to purchase this machine today, this 100 crore rupees, what you are doing is you are borrowing. So on that borrowing, you will also incur some interest. So now the question here is that this interest, will you capitalize or capitalize to the cost of machinery or not? I'll repeat the question, understand properly. So today you want to purchase a machine worth 100 crores and for that you also get a borrowing. In that borrowing, you incur some borrowing cost, which is interest. Okay. So now the question here is that this interest, will you capitalize? That means, will you add it to the cost of the machinery or not? So first, let's recall, when will you capitalize? When will you capitalize the interest? You will only capitalize the interest if the asset is a qualifying asset. If the asset is a qualifying asset. So now you have to tell me whether this machinery is a qualifying asset or not. Now here, what did we read? A qualifying asset is asset which necessarily takes 12 months to get ready for its use or sale. Now here, this machinery, when you are going to purchase it, it is going to be ready-made only. It is going to be ready-made only. Correct. So it will not take you 12 months to make it ready for your use or for the sale. Okay, so it is not going to take you 12 months because it is already ready-made only. So once you purchase, it is ready only. So in such case, this will not be a qualifying asset and your interest rate cannot be capitalized. So no, your interest rate cannot be capitalized. It will be debited to your P&L account. It will be debited to your P&L account. So hope this is clear. So next example is, if there is a ship, and this ship will take 13 months to build it. If we are going to take 13 months to build a ship, whether this will be known as a qualifying asset or not, and whether we'll capitalize the interest or not. The answer is yes, this will be considered as a capital asset. Now, what happens is wine. So, wine is there. And what happens is you sell wine. Your business is to sell wine, and the production of such wine takes around 18 months. So 18 months is more than 12 months only. Okay. So if you are taking more than 18 months to get it ready for, see, either get ready for either use or for sale. Here ship was getting ready to use, but downwards here. Here the ship was getting ready to use, but downwards here you are using. I mean, you are going to get the wine ready for sale. So whatever case it may be, if you are taking it more than 12 months to get it ready, then in such case this will be also known as your qualifying asset only. So always remember, qualifying asset can be both fixed asset as well as current asset. It can be both fixed as well as current asset, because you can see here the ship is their fixed asset, whereas the wine is like their inventory. So inventory means it is nothing but their stock. And what is stock? Stock is your current asset only. So qualifying asset, it's not like it should not be, what do you say, fixed asset, or it should not be current asset. So qualifying asset can be both fixed or current. It should satisfy the condition of substantial period of time to get ready for its use or sale. So if it satisfies that condition, then in such case it will be a qualifying asset, and whatever the interest you incur on such making of such asset, you can capitalize it. Okay. So I hope this is clear to you. Here they have also given a few examples of qualifying asset: manufacturing plants, power generation facilities, inventories that require a substantial period of time to bring them to saleable condition, example wine, and investment properties. Okay, fine. So I hope all of these you would have understood. So now, until now, what you have understood what is borrowing cost, and you have understood what is qualifying asset, and you have understood when this borrowing cost will be capitalized or it will be given to P&L. So when will you capitalize? When it is a qualifying asset. And when will you send it to P&L? When it is a other than qualifying asset. Other than qualifying asset. So these three things you have understood till now. Okay, so now let's move on to the next topic. Okay, yes. So here it is given. So borrowing costs that are directly attributable to the acquisition, construction, or production of a qualifying asset, you can capitalize it. So which is directly attributable to the acquisition, construction, or production of qualifying asset, you can capitalize it. So until now we read that if the borrowing cost is related to qualifying asset, you can capitalize. So until now what did we read? If the borrowing cost is related to qualifying asset, or if the borrowing is made for a qualifying asset, on that whatever cost you incur, you can capitalize it. But here they are adding something. This borrowing cost should be directly attributable to the acquisition, construction, or production. So what does this means is what we are going to understand now. Okay, so what they say is borrowing can be of two types. Borrowing can be, take out the cost, borrowing can be of two types. One is specific borrowings, other one is general borrowing. So one is specific borrowings, other is general borrowings. So now we are going to understand what are the two types of borrowings. What is specific borrowing? What is general borrowing? Okay. So what is specific borrowing? So specific borrowing means to make a qualifying asset, you have taken 1 crore rupees as bank loan. So to make a qualifying asset, you have taken 1 crore rupees as bank loan at 11% interest. So this is known as a specific borrowing. This is known as a specific borrowing, that specifically for this qualifying asset only you have taken this 1 crore rupees, not for any other purpose. So specifically to make or construct or acquire this qualifying asset only you have taken a bank loan. Okay, so this is a specific borrowing, that specifically for one purpose only you have taken, and that purpose is qualifying asset. So this will be known as your borrowing cost. So in this case, this borrowing, okay, or whatever the borrowing cost that you are going to incur on this borrowing is directly attributable to qualifying asset. So this is directly attributable to qualifying asset. So in such case, what will happen? This borrowing cost shall be capitalized. So in such case, this borrowing cost shall be capitalized. So if you are going to pay 11% interest on this bank loan, it will be capitalized because it is directly or specific borrowings are directly related to qualifying asset. Okay. So now to the next point, I'll come a little bit later. Now first, let's understand what is general borrowings. So in such case, so now what has happened is you have taken 2 crores from debentures. You have taken 2 crores by issuing debentures at 9%. Then you have taken 2.5 crores from bank loan at 10% interest. And then you have taken 5.5 crores for the debentures by issuing debentures at 8.5%. So totally you have taken 2 crores, 2.5 crores and 5.5 crores. But this money you have not taken to construct a qualifying asset. Generally, you have taken it as a loan. There is no specific purpose related to this. So generally, you have taken this money as loan. You thought that now I'll take some amount of money for loan and for various purpose, I will use this. So in your mind, it was not that for qualifying asset only, I'm going to take this loan. No. Here, generally, you have taken loan for various purposes. One of which purpose can be qualifying asset. Okay, so this money, if you have extra money, you can use for qualifying asset. But specifically for qualifying asset, you have not taken this loan. So this will be known as a general borrowing. So here what has happened is, for the construction of qualifying asset, if you need 4 crores, you can take 4 crores from this amount of money. But this amount of money was not specifically for qualifying asset, but in case you want to construct a qualifying asset, then in such case from this general borrowings you can pick up 4 crores. Okay, so I hope until this you would have understood what is the difference between specific borrowings and general borrowings. Okay, so in specific borrowings I told you that whatever the interest is. So here I told you that whatever the interest is, suppose if it is 11% interest or whatever the total interest amount is, you will totally capitalize it. But here, now what has happened is, now since you have taken 4 crores for your qualifying asset, here there is no specific, specific interest rate which is related to it, because you have taken 3 different forms of borrowings. Okay, so now here how will you calculate how much is the borrowing cost related to this qualifying asset, or how much borrowing cost should be capitalized related to this qualifying asset. So now what you are going to do is, here to first you have to find out the interest rate. To find out borrowing cost, you have to first find out the interest rate. So now here how will you find out the interest rate is that? So here how will you find out the interest rate is that? See, what we will do is, we'll apply a method known as weighted average method. So here what you are going to do is, you have 3 interest rate. Here it is not like 4 lakh specifically you have taken from this or this or this. So it's not given anything like that. 4 crore rupees you have taken. But from which you have taken or what you have taken, it's not written here. So what you do is, you'll apply a method known as weighted average. So what you do is, in simple average, so usually what you would have done nothing known as simple average. That means if I would have asked you what is the average interest rate that we have to pay on 4 crores, if I ask you what is the average interest rate that you have to pay on 4 crores, what will you do? You will do 9% plus 10% plus 8.5% by 3 and whatever amount you get. And whatever amount you get, you will tell that this much amount is what you have to pay on 4 crores. Usually, a normal person would do this. But what AS16 has told you, that you must not do simple average. You must do weighted average and only find out how much interest you have to pay on this 4 crores. So weighted average, what you will do, along with this, you will take some weights. So usually how we did, 9%, 10%, then 8.5%. Along with this, you have to add the weights. That means how much borrowings you have done. So here you have done for 2 crores. Here you have done for 2.5 crores. And here at this interest rate, you have taken 5.5 crores. Okay. So you will do 2 into 9 plus 2.5 into 10 plus 5.5 into 8.5 divided by the total weights. Okay. So now what you will do is that, divided by, again, the weights you will take 2.5 and 5.5. Okay, so this is how you do weighted average. So if you divide, then you will get 8.975%. So 8.975%. So the interest rate for this 4 crore rupees is 8.975%. So using weighted average method only, you have to find out the interest rate when you are taking a qualifying asset, or when you are taking the money for qualifying asset from general borrowings. So you have to apply weighted average method and find. So now we have found out 8.975%. So this interest rate you will capitalize. So this interest alone you will capitalize. So from the general borrowings, the interest which is related to qualifying asset will alone get capitalized, whereas the remaining interest, or the loan or the borrowing which is taken for other purpose other than qualifying asset, for any other purpose, that will be taken to P&L account only. Only the interest which is related to the qualifying asset or directly attributable to the qualifying asset will be capitalized. Okay, fine. See here, interest charged to P&L will be the total interest minus the interest on qualifying asset which has been capitalized. So I hope you would have understood until now. So you would have understood what is specific borrowings, what is general borrowings. In specific borrowings, the total interest you will capitalize, whereas in general borrowings, which is directly attributable to qualifying asset alone, you will capitalize. And how will you find out that interest rate? Using weighted average method. Okay, fine. So this both you would have understood. So now one thing that you will have to keep in mind regarding specific borrowings is that what they tell you is, see, suppose you have borrowed 1 crore rupees. Suppose you have borrowed 1 crore rupees at 15% per annum. Okay. If you have borrowed 1 crore rupees at 15% per annum, how much is the interest you have to pay? 1 crore into 15%. That is 15 lakh rupees interest you have to pay every year. Okay. So now what they say is, in this 1 crore rupees, now, right now, you only need 75 lakh rupees. Right now, you only need 75 lakh rupees. Remaining 25 lakh is not required now. 25 lakh is not required now. So what you say, this 20 lakh, if it is going to sit idle, then it is like no use at all. So what they do is, until and unless they don't need this 25 lakh rupees, what they do is, they take this 25 lakh rupees and invest it somewhere else. They take this 25 lakh rupees and invest it somewhere else from where they are getting 10% return. So that the money which is idle is also not getting wasted, and you are earning from that also. Okay. So if you are getting 10% return on 25 lakh rupees, that means you are earning an income of 2.5 lakh. So here what they are saying, if there is some situation like this, where you have borrowed 1 crore and you have only used 75 lakhs and the remaining 25 lakhs was not using, or you were not using it and it was idle, and you have invested it somewhere else, and by investing it somewhere else, if you have got some return, in such case, what you will do is, your borrowing cost. In such case, you have to do borrowing cost net interest. That means the amount that you will be capitalized will be net of interest. That means total interest that you are going to pay is 15 lakh. But 2.5 lakh rupees you have got as an income. So 15 lakh you are going to pay. So it is cost. 2.5 lakh rupees you have earned by investing it somewhere else. So it is an income. So the borrowing cost net interest is 12,50,000. This is nothing but 15 lakh minus 2.5 lakh. So here what they say is 12.5 lakh rupees only you will capitalize. Okay. So before we were saying that the whole 15 lakh should be capitalized because it was taken for the purpose of qualifying asset. But now what they are saying is, if there is some income earned on some temporary investment, this temporary investment only I have done for 25 lakh, because after some time you will take out this investment and you will again use it for the asset. Okay. Then in such case, what will happen is, it will be deducted from the borrowing cost. So you have to deduct it from the borrowing cost, which we have done here, and the remaining amount shall be capitalized. That is 12,50,000 shall alone be capitalized or added to the cost of the asset. So the cost of the asset, qualifying asset, was 1 crore rupees. In that, how much interest you will add? 12,50,000. 12,50,000 you will add. So 112. Okay, that is 1 crore 12,50,000. what you are going to do is that will be the cost of your asset. That will be the cost of your asset. Okay. So I hope this you would have understood. So I'll just see if there is any other topic that has been left out by me. Okay. Yes. So until now, first we'll revise whatever we had studied, and then I'll move on to my next topic. So first we have understood what is borrowing cost. There is interest cost and there are various other costs also. Okay, then you understood what is qualifying asset. You understood when the borrowing cost will be capitalized. It will only be capitalized when it is a qualifying asset. That you learned. And then you learned about two borrowings, specific borrowings and general borrowings. You learned that specific borrowing, the whole interest will be capitalized, but net of temporary investment or the income that you earned from temporary investment. In general borrowings, you'll use weighted average method to find out the interest rate of qualifying asset, and that interest will be capitalized. And the remaining interest of general borrowings will be put onto P&L account. Okay, so now the last and final topic for the day. Yes, so now let's understand. So now we are going to move on to a topic known as period of capitalization of borrowing cost. Period of capitalization of borrowing cost. So what they say is whenever there is a qualifying asset that is being made or constructed or whatever it is, there are three stages. There are totally three stages. First stage is the commencement stage. The first is your commencement stage. Okay. Then it goes on, goes on, goes on, and finally the asset is being made and it ends. Okay. So what they say is when you are going to capitalizing your borrowing cost, how much amount should you capitalize? Okay. Until what period should you capitalize it? Okay. So until what period should you capitalize your borrowing cost is what we are going to understand now. That means throughout this period, should you capitalize the borrowing cost, or is there is some kind of a hindrance that your borrowing cost capitalization will stop in between and for the remaining period you will go into P&L. Okay. How is it? You will understand clearly now. So now let's start with the commencement of capitalization. So when will you start capitalizing? So when will you start capitalizing means when will you, it means when will you start adding, sorry, when will you start adding your interest to the cost of qualifying asset, to the cost of qualifying asset. So this is what it means. Commencement of capitalization means when will you start adding your interest to the cost of qualifying asset? When will you start? Okay, today itself you should start. That is when you start making the qualifying asset itself, you should start adding it to the cost. Or when should you? Okay, so here what they say is capitalization of borrowing cost should commence when all the following conditions are satisfied. Capitalization of borrowing cost should commence, or you should start capitalizing your borrowing cost when all the following conditions are satisfied. Even if one condition is not satisfied, you cannot capitalize your borrowing cost. Then in such case, if you don't even follow, I mean, if you are not fulfilling any one of the condition also, you cannot capitalize. Okay, then in such case, what will you do with that borrowing cost if you're not capitalizing? In such case, you will put the borrowing cost in P&L account and debit it. Okay, so I hope you would have understood. So now we will see what are the conditions that you have to fulfill to capitalize your borrowing cost or to commence the capitalization. Okay, what they say is the expenditure for acquisition, construction or production of a qualifying asset is being incurred. That means you must be spending money. You must be spending some money for the acquisition or for the construction or for the production of the qualifying asset. You must be spending some money. That means expenditure must be incurred. Okay, so if you are spending some money, then in that case, that is one condition. What is the second condition? Second condition is borrowing costs are being incurred. So what does it mean that borrowing costs are being incurred? So here I've already told you that you must spend some money. Then what is the difference between spending money and borrowing cost being incurred. So here the difference, what is here is that, so wait 1 minute. Okay, yes, so I think now it's clear. Okay, so the difference between the both is that, see here, the money which you are spending on the qualifying asset, it can either be borrowed money or it can be not a borrowed money. Suppose you are spending 1 crore rupees on the asset, and for that asset 75 lakh rupees you have borrowed and 25 lakh rupees you have not borrowed. And in such case, if you are using this 25 lakh rupees here, that means on this 25 lakhs there is no borrowing cost that is going to be incurred, because this 25 lakhs is not your borrowing, which the money which you are spending should also be your borrowed money. Then only you will be able to incur your borrowing cost. Now suppose you are spending the 75 lakh rupees, then in such case your borrowing cost, you will also have to pay interest on it. So borrowing cost should also be incurred, and this money that you are spending, if it is your borrowed money, then you will incur your borrowing cost. Okay, and the expenditure should be incurring only. It should either be for acquisition, construction or production. Okay, fine. The third condition is that activities that are necessary to prepare the asset for its intended use or sale are in progress. So what they say is, it is not only enough if you are spending the money or if you are incurring the borrowing cost. It is also important that there is some kind of activity which is in progress in related to the qualifying asset. Some kind of activity must be happening. Okay, so now what happens is that if you want to construct a house, for that you borrow 75 lakh rupees, and you are spending that 75 lakh rupees on the house. You are also incurring borrowing cost. But in this house or related to this house, there is no work that is happening. There is no work in progress, or there is no activities that is happening. Then in such case, you cannot capitalize. Some or the other activity must be in progress. When I am saying some or the other activities in progress, it means that not only physical activities, that not only construction of this house. By activities, what I mean is that it can also mean that you would want some permission for the house. So that permission process is taking place, or some kind of a designing for the house is happening. That means you are preparing a design plan. That here this room must be there, here this hall must be there, here this kitchen must be there. Some kind of a designing also you are doing. This doesn't mean that you are constructing. Taking permission from the higher authorities is not that you are doing some physical activity. But it is some kind of a activity related to the qualifying asset only, and some kind of a activity is in progress. Okay. And designing also you are doing. It's okay if you have not started constructing, but here what you are doing is, you are doing some activity related to the qualifying asset, that you are designing some kind of a floor plan or something. So if these three conditions are satisfied, you can commence the capitalization of borrowing cost. First condition, expenditure must be incurred in relation to the qualifying asset, that it can be for acquisition, construction or production. Borrowing cost must be incurred, and activities which are necessary to prepare the asset. Here activities in progress, but what activities? Activities that are necessary to prepare the asset for its intended use or sale should be in progress. Okay, necessary activities. So taking permission is a necessary activity? Yes. Designing the plan or the structure of the house, is it a necessary activity? Yes. Okay. So what is not a necessary activity then? Suppose what you are doing is that you are going and seeing that house. So seeing the house is an activity only. It is related to the qualifying asset only. But is it necessary for that for the asset to bring it into a position where it can be used or sold? No. So this is not a necessary activity. So if this is some kind of activity which is going on, then you cannot capitalize. Only if you are seeing and there is no work happening, then it's of no use. Then in such case, you cannot capitalize. Okay. So these three conditions must be met. Okay. So in such case, you can start capitalizing. Okay. So we told when we can start capitalizing. But here, what we are going to understand is when you can suspend the capitalization. When you can suspend the capitalization, suspension. So suspension word is temporary. So what here I want to tell you is that from your school, you can, for doing some kind of a misbehavior, you can either be suspended or you can be given your TC. transfer certificate. Once again, or you can be given your TC. If you are suspended from the school, you can, there is a chance that you come back to school. That 15 days suspension, 20 days suspension, 1 month suspension, it means that it is temporary period, you will not be coming to school. But if they give you a TC, then permanently you are thrown out of the school. So this is the difference. Here we are not talking about the TC case, we are talking about the suspension case. That means temporarily. For temporary, you have to suspend your capitalization. That means this whole period you have started capitalizing, but in between, for some period alone, you will stop capitalizing it, or you will suspend your capitalization and you will put it into P&L. The borrowing cost you will transfer to P&L. Okay, so what is that suspension, or when will you suspend the capitalization is what we are going to understand now. How in school for some misbehavior you are being suspended, here the same way, when you will suspend the capitalization. So capitalization of borrowing cost should be suspended during extended points in which active development is interrupted. In which active development is interrupted, very very important point, in which active development is interrupted. So if any active development is interrupted, then in such case you can suspend your capitalization. So what does active development is interrupted means? So here we'll take 2 to 3 examples to understand better. So here once again I'll show you. Okay fine. See, so now what happens is that you have started capitalizing this thing, and your activities for the qualifying asset has happened. Now what has happened is that in between there came a period, where all your labor went on strike, and what happened was your active development was interrupted. That means the development of the qualifying asset was interrupted. Okay, so here what happened was that the active development was interrupted. Here what they say is capitalization of borrowing asset should be suspended in which active development is interrupted. So here what happened is the active development being interrupted, there is no development on the qualifying asset because all the labor are on strike. So there is no active development that is happening. So here what will happen is you will have to suspend your capitalization of borrowing cost. So your borrowing cost will no more be capitalized for this period alone. After this period, once the labor are back to work, you can start capitalizing it. Okay. The next example is that what happens is that between again came a period where what happened is that you completed construction of your first floor. But to start construction of your second floor, you needed a permission. Okay. And for the permission, for receiving the permission of the second floor itself, what happened? 2 months time they took to approve the permission. 2 months time they took to approve or give the permission. So for those 2 months, you were not able to. So for those 2 months, you were not able to do or develop. So for those 2 months, what happens is that you were not able to actively develop the asset because all the work was stopped. You were not able to start with the construction of second floor because the permission you did not get. So in such case also your active development has been interrupted. But in this case your borrowing cost will be capitalized. This will not be suspended. This will be capitalized. Why? Why was it that in the first case it was suspended, in the second case it is not being suspended, is what we are going to understand now. See, I already told you that you can capitalize, okay, you can capitalize your asset if there is some kind of activity that is in progress. Here there was no activity that was there in progress, which was necessary for the preparation of the asset or assets intended use or sale. But here taking of this permission is a necessary activity to prepare the asset. It is a necessary activity to prepare the asset for the intended use or sale. So that's the reason you will be capitalizing the borrowing cost and it will not be suspended. See here, capitalization of borrowing cost is not suspended. When a temporary delay is necessary part of the process. Okay, for this now I will give you an example. Wait, first we'll read this sentence. Now ignore this. See, capitalization of borrowing cost is not normally substandard during a period when substantial technical and administrative work is being carried out. So what was the example of technical or administrative work? It was getting permission. So in such case, it will not be suspended. Here there is one more case where they say capitalization of borrowing cost will also not be suspended when there is a temporary delay which is necessary as a part of the process of an asset getting ready. So what is this? Now let's see this example. So here also what happens, asset started, they started making an asset, and then in between there was a period when the active development was interrupted. Why was the active development was interrupted? Because they were constructing a bridge. Okay. They were constructing a bridge above sea. So what happened? Here below there is water, and above the sea they are constructing a bridge. What happened was that it was a rainy season. So since it was a rainy season, the rain started pouring heavily. So due to the rain, what happened is the sea levels arose. So due to the sea levels coming up, the bridge was not able to be built and all the work had to be stopped. Because why was the construction of a bridge was interrupted? It was interrupted due to the rise in water level. Why did the water level rise? Because it was a rainy season. And in that moment, you cannot go and you can say that in water also I'll construct the bridge. You cannot do crazy things like that. So you had to stop your construction. So in such case, what was this? This was a temporary delay only, because once the rain subsides, you will go and start with your work again. But this was necessary part of the process, because if you didn't stop the work then what will happen? You cannot go about it, right? So this was a necessary part only. Unnecessarily you didn't stop the work. This was necessary part only for getting the asset ready for its use or sale. So in such case also, the borrowing cost will be capitalized and the borrowing cost will not be suspended from being capitalized. Okay, so it will be capitalized. There will be no suspension. Okay, so I hope you understood the three situations. So here they say, for example, capitalization continues, blah, 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 inventories, high levels, water delay, construction of bridge. This is what I told you. Okay, so I hope this suspension topic is also clear to you. When you will suspend and when you will not suspend. Okay, so the final topic is about cessation of capitalization. Cessation means TC. That means after this point, you will not capitalize it. Okay. Yes, fine. Permanently or stopping the capitalization. Okay. So here what they say is capitalization of borrowing costs should cease. Should cease means it should permanently stop. From capitalizing when substantially all activities necessary to prepare the qualifying asset are complete. When substantially all the activities are complete. So here what they are trying to tell. So what they are trying to say is, first I'll give you one example. Suppose there is a building. Suppose this is a building that you have constructed. And what happens is that in this building, you have constructed all the rooms or all the floors and all the interior and everything is done. Only fitting of taps is remaining. All other work has been completed. If you fit the tap, then 100% of your work will also get complete. 100% of the work will get complete. Okay. So here, in this case, in this situation, the question here is whether the borrowing cost that you are incurring, whether you will capitalize it or not. Here what they are saying is that capitalization of borrowing cost shall cease when substantially all the activities are complete. Here they are saying that even if you have not completed 100% of the activities, substantially if you have completed all the activities which were necessary to prepare the qualifying asset. So here, if you fit the tab, it's over. But substantially, that is maximum, or everything is complete, right? So maximum, everything is complete here. So substantially, everything is completed which is necessary to prepare the qualifying asset. So in such case, this can, so here in this case, for this building, whatever loan you had taken, or for the construction, whatever loan you had taken, on that borrowing, whatever cost you are incurring, borrowing cost, you will no more capitalize it. You must stop capitalizing it and it will go into P&L. So here substantially complete means how much percent complete, 90% or 95%. They have not given any measure here. So it depends. Okay, so substantially completion depends here. So if you have substantially completed all the activities which were necessary, so then in such case, you can stop your capitalization. Okay, fine. So here what they are saying is that, see, an asset is normally ready for its intended use or sale when physical construction or production is complete. So it is normally ready for intended use or sale when physical construction or production is complete, even though routine administrative work might still continue. So here they tell you that, see, the physical, so if they, what they are saying is, in case you have done, you have constructed the building, now the process for advertising this building is going on to, so that people can come and buy. Okay, so advertising work, that and all is going on, that is, you know, that shall not be considered. So it is considered complete only. Okay, so what they say here is, if minor modifications are there, like you have to fit a tap or fit a bulb or fit a fan, or you have to clean the house because there is so much of mess in this, or you have to clean the building once it is done because there will be a lot of dust, no? So like this, if there is small work or small modifications which are there, which you have to do, so that such as decoration of a property to the user specification or something like that, in such case, you will still consider that is substantially all the activities are completed. You will still take it as account that substantially all the activities are completed. Okay. So in this case, you can stop your capitalization is what they're trying to say here. Okay. So here there is one final thing that I wanted to convey. It is about qualifying asset completed in parts. Suppose you are constructing a building of four floors. Suppose you are constructing a building of four floors. And in that, if the first floor is complete, and in that, if the first floor is complete, then in such case, what will you do? If only the first floor is complete, or substantially all the activities related to only the first floor is complete, what you do? Here we understood for the whole building what we'll do in the last case. That if substantially all the activities of the whole building are complete. But now we are going to understand if substantially all the activities of only one floor. Okay, or one part, not one floor. Here what I mean is, of one part, if it is completed, then in such case also the capitalization related to that one floor, related to that one floor alone should stop, related to that one floor or one part should alone stop. Okay, so here what this is, when the construction of a qualifying asset is completed in parts. So here the construction is completed in parts only. Only the first floor is completed. And a completed part is capable of being used. Is this first part capable of being used? Yes, it is capable of being used. While construction, so while construction continues for other parts. So here for second, third and fourth floor, here still the construction is ongoing only. So in such case, the capitalizations shall cease when substantially all activities necessary to prepare that part means the first floor, are complete. So if it is complete, then for this alone, the capitalization can stop. For the remaining three floors, floor 2, 3 and 4, since the construction is still ongoing, for this the capitalization shall continue. For this the capitalization shall continue. Okay. So yes guys, so I've covered all the topics of AS 16. Yes, so I hope you found this accounting standard 16 borrowing cost in the way that I explained helpful. So if you did, please do like, share and subscribe to the channel. And if you found this helpful, do leave a comment down below. And we'll meet you in the next video with all the sums related to this standard, guys. So until then, keep supporting. Thank you.